Good evening. Wherever you are in the world, welcome to the second night of Big Bang Week. My name is Adrian Turpin. My day job is the director of the Wigtown Book Festival. And I'm here tonight in Wigtown, which is Scotland's national book town. And it's also, how great for us, on the edge of the Galloway International Dark Sky Park, which is the inspiration for the Big Bang Week Festival. Now, tonight we're here to celebrate the life of James Clerk Maxwell, Scotland's Einstein, the nation's greatest scientist, or as we like to say in Galloway, Galloway's greatest scientist. A man whose work has inspired and enabled so much of what we take for granted in the 21st century, but which not so long ago would have felt like magic. And to do this, we've got two very special guests tonight. We've got Professor Catherine Heymans, the Astronomer Royal for Scotland, who works out of the Royal Observatory, Edinburgh. And her speciality is cosmic weak gravitational lensing, which has also been amazing since she's taken up that role as the 11th Astronomer Royal at promoting astronomy generally, getting telescopes into schools. And her partner in crime tonight is Martin Hendry, who is Professor of Gravitational Astrophysics and Cosmology at the University of Glasgow. And he's also sometimes described as a black hole hunter. So I'm going to hand over to them, and they're going to take you on a bit of a magical mystery tour. But before that, on your behalf and on our behalf, I want to give them a big, big bang welcome and say thank you for coming tonight and for talking about such an influential figure in the history of science.
Hello, good evening, everyone.
Hi, everybody.
Thanks so much for welcoming us to Big Bang Week, and my apologies, there's a bit of a delay on my video, but hopefully you can hear me okay. And Martin's gone in the spinning dial on his side, so anyway, happily, tonight we have made a very special video for you. Martin and I are, I'm a fellow and Martin's a trustee of the James Clerk Maxwell Foundation. And we're very lucky that the foundation let us go and film there and show you some of the things from James Clerk Maxwell's house. So we're going to run you through his life and legacy.
And while that video is playing, we'll be more than happy to answer questions on YouTube, just in the text box. But we'll be back live at the end of the video to answer questions in real time as well. Well, almost real time in Catherine's case. We think it's real time in terms of the sound, but with a slight delay in the light. I'm sure James Clerk Maxwell would have been very intrigued by that, Catherine. But we'll work around that, no problem.
So without further ado, for the fine technical people at the Big Bang end, please could you run our very splendid video?
Welcome to 14 India Place, Edinburgh, the birthplace of Scotland's very own Einstein, a scientist called James Clerk Maxwell. I'm Catherine Heymans, I'm a professor here at the University of Edinburgh, and I'm also the Astronomer Royal for Scotland.
And I'm Martin Hendry, I'm professor at the University of Glasgow, and I'm a black hole hunter. And lots more about black holes later. But the connection between James Clerk Maxwell and black holes is through Einstein. So many people talk about Maxwell as Scotland's own Einstein. And there's a real truth to that, because Einstein's remarkable discoveries about space and time in the early 20th century, what we call his theories of relativity, Einstein acknowledged that they owe a lot to the foundations laid by James Clerk Maxwell himself. So it's great to be here in Maxwell's house, because we can explore some of the science that Maxwell developed. And well, let's go and do that, Catherine.
So here he is, the great scientist, James Clerk Maxwell. He was born just upstairs in 1831. Now, Martin, would you describe him as a mathematician or a physicist?
It's a really good question. When you look at the painting, Catherine, this is a painting of James Clerk Maxwell in the more mature phase of his life. It's quite sad to note at the same time that he died when he was only 48. So who knows what he might have achieved if he'd lived longer. But this later phase of his life, he was primarily known as a theoretician. He was working on aspects of theoretical physics that we'll discuss a little bit later on. But when he was a younger scientist, he was very interested in everyday aspects of ideas like colour.
Yeah.
And in fact, the hallmark of his work on that is that he was looking not just at the theory, but also simple practical experiments that anyone can do, you know, maybe just using the equipment they have around the house. And this reflects the fact that he had very broad interests, not just in science, what nowadays we call physics, but how physics fitted into the natural world around us. You know, so understanding ideas like colour was very much part of him just seeking to understand the everyday world that he lived in. Mm-hmm. And I think we're going to look at some aspects of those colour experiments now.
All right, we have here a replica of Maxwell's colour top. You can see it spins around and it's got at the top, hopefully you can see that, red, green, yellow and blue. Now, he was really, really interested in colour early on in his scientific career. And he had friends who were painters and they knew how to mix the colours together. They knew that you just needed three primary colours to mix together to make all of the other colours. He also was friends with a biologist who had been looking at eyes, and they had discovered that there were receptors at the back of the eyes, but just three of them. And that got him thinking about the fact that colour that we see could be created from just three primary colours. So this sort of thing is a way of mixing colour in terms of light, but it's a bit clunky. So using equipment that you have around your house, I've got here a CD player, and we've got the three primary colours here. So the primary colours for light are not the same as the primary colours for paint. This is what Maxwell discovered. The primary colours for light are green, blue and red. And what we can do is switch this on. We can start mixing them, mixing the light. And what you should be able to see is that that light is appearing white. If it span a bit faster, if my batteries weren't running out, then you would see it spinning even faster. And so that was one of his very first discoveries, that light, the white light that we see, or is made up of just three primary colours, red, green and blue. Now, he went on and used this amazing discovery to cause a huge furore at the Royal Institute. And Martin, I think you've got his slides.
Yes, I know.
Or at least a replica of them.
Again, we must remember he was doing all of this when he was a relatively young man. He was only 23 when he published a paper on the effects of mixing these primary colours, as Catherine was just describing. But very soon thereafter, he was able to demonstrate at the Royal Institution how you could turn this into a practical procedure for taking colour photographs. So really, Maxwell, we should recognise as the first person to ever take a colour photograph. And these slides here, we can maybe see that they're coloured, but to see them to better effect, we're going to have to move to the window and let in some natural light. So we're now by the window in 14 India Street, Maxwell's birthplace, and that lets us use some natural light to illustrate the key principles behind Maxwell's colour photography. So what we first of all have here is three coloured filters. So, you know, think of like Quality Street, you know, other chocolate sweets are available. Often the sweets are wrapped in coloured translucent paper, paper that you can see through. So it's a little bit like that. And if you hold one of these up, then everything looks blue. And there's another one, which will make everything look red. And a third one, which will make everything look green. So Maxwell's approach was, with hindsight, rather simple. It was to take a photograph through each of these three filters, red, blue, and green. And then when you combine those photographs together, what you're doing is you're reconstructing the true colours that our eyes would see when you're looking at that object in the first place. Now, what object did Maxwell choose? Well, he's Scotland's most famous scientist, one might say. So what more obvious choice than a piece of coloured tartan? And that's what Maxwell photographed. We've got three photographic plates here. So this is the red one. It's an image of a piece of tartan, but taken with that red filter. And it's maybe a little hard to see in this light, but that means that the tartan looks distinctly reddishly tinged. But remember, that's only the first taken through the red filter. And what also needs to be done is to take that photograph of the same piece of tartan through the green filter, and then a third photograph through the blue filter. And then those three photographic plates taken through those three coloured filters, when they're taken together, what you get, and here's the big reveal, you get a photograph like this, which is the combined image showing the light passing through each of those filters, and sure enough, it blends together, just like Catherine's rotating demo was doing a few minutes ago, to produce a colour image of the original tartan. So this was displayed in 1861, and it really did cause quite a stir. Our next Maxwell milestone takes us all the way into space, but via Aberdeen. By the year 1756, Maxwell was Professor of Natural Philosophy at Marischal College in Aberdeen. Natural philosophy is what we nowadays refer to as physics. And during the first few years of Maxwell's time in Aberdeen, he managed to solve a puzzle that had perplexed astronomers for 200 years. The question was, what are Saturn's rings made of? Now, here's a modern day view of Saturn's rings. This was taken by the Voyager spacecraft in the early 1980s. I was at high school then, and yeah, it's one of the things that persuaded me to become an astronomer was the amazing images that Voyager was sending back from Jupiter and Saturn around that time. But you don't need to go all the way to Saturn with a spacecraft to know that Saturn has got rings. You can see the rings through even a small telescope here on Earth. And the first astronomer to do that was Christian Huygens in 1655. Here's the drawing that he drew of Saturn that he saw through his telescope. Now, his telescope wasn't that good, and he could tell that the rings went all the way around the planet. But his best guess was that the rings were completely solid. But then 100 years later, the French mathematician Pierre-Simon Laplace was able to prove mathematically that if the rings were completely solid, the orbits would be unstable. So what Pierre-Simon Laplace said was that the rings had to be a series of solid ringlets, a bit like having a set of hula hoops all nested one inside the other. And in some ways, that's what this photograph seems to be looking like. This is a really beautiful image taken by another spacecraft, the Cassini mission, that went to Saturn in the early 2000s. But then along comes James Clerk Maxwell. And in 1859, he solved this puzzle by showing that even the solid ringlets of Laplace's model, that didn't work either. That basically the rings would break apart, they wouldn't be stable, or the material would all bunch up together and become lumpy. And he also looked at another possibility, which was that the rings were a smooth fluid, like made of liquid or gas, and that didn't work either. He went on to consider the third possibility, and that's what is in fact the true situation for Saturn's rings. So this is an artist's impression, but it's fully consistent with the model that Maxwell developed. And that model was that the rings are made of countless numbers of individual particles all orbiting Saturn on their own individual orbits. We now know that those particles range in size from, you know, a few centimetres to maybe a few metres, but Maxwell showed that that was the only way that you could have the rings stable for a significant length of time around Saturn. So this was really quite remarkable. What Maxwell had done was use pure maths to learn something important about a planet that was more than a billion miles away from the Earth. And you didn't need to send a spacecraft or build a really big telescope. You could just use theory, pure maths, to work it out. And this would set the tone for discoveries that would follow. Now, in the late 1800s, in 1895, astronomers used light to study the absorption and the scattering of light from the rings of Saturn, and that backed up Maxwell's ideas too. And then, of course, we have the studies that were carried out by Voyager and Cassini, the spacecraft that went there. But in a way, you didn't need any of that. You just needed the pure mass theory in the first place. So this way in which we could learn profound things about the universe from theory would set the tone for some quite amazing discoveries that would follow, like the prediction of the Higgs boson, for example, the fundamental particle that was discovered in the early 2000s. And this relationship between theory and the nature of our universe
Well, that would also be developed by Einstein himself and his remarkable ideas about space and time, which we're going to talk about a little later.
Now, James Clerk Maxwell was a really novel scientist because he used the language of mathematics to describe the observations that the experimental physicists of the time were making, be that to do with coloured light or the rings of Saturn. And his most groundbreaking work happened when he turned his attention to the phenomena that were taking place in Michael Faraday's laboratory. The first experiment we're going to call a confused compass. Now, if you put a compass near a wire that's carrying electricity, it no longer points to the magnetic north. Somehow, the electricity in the wire is confusing the magnet in the compass and telling it to point elsewhere. Our next experiment we'll call the confused copper. If I spin a copper disc inside a strong magnet, electricity is created. Somehow that the magnet is confusing the copper into creating electric charge. Finally, one of my absolute all-time favorite experiments to do, scatter some iron filings around a magnet. They won't fall randomly on the surface. They'll form these patterns, these lines that trace out the invisible force field that surrounds magnets. It's really strange to think about invisible force fields. The one you're probably most familiar with is gravity. That's an invisible force that's pulling you down onto the Earth at the moment. And what James Clerk Maxwell realized was that there was an invisible force field around magnets and around electric charges. And so he wrote this down mathematically. Here are his famous Maxwell's equations. Don't worry, I'm not going to take you through them. But these four key equations here describe all of those phenomena that I just took you through by making the amazing realization that electricity and magnetism are inherently linked. There's a single electromagnetic force field that means that the force around magnets can impact electric charges, and the force around electric charges can impact magnets. Now, here it gets really mind-blowing what he did next. He started thinking about energy being transported through these force fields, these invisible force fields. Okay, really strange to think about. So let's take ourselves back to gravity. I'm about to put my own personal chemical energy into some kinetic energy to boost myself up into space. Ready? Now, obviously, I came back down again, but that wasn't my own personal energy that brought me back down again. That was gravity. The force field of gravity gave me potential energy that pulled me back down again. All right, so energy and forces are closely linked. All right, let's imagine now a pond, a very still pond, and I'm going to put energy into that pond by throwing a stone into the middle of it. Now that energy is going to move out across the surface of the pond in a wave, a ripple that takes the energy from the center where I threw the stone all the way out to the edges of the pond. Now James Clerk Maxwell thought to himself, well, how fast would a wave of energy travel in this invisible electromagnetic force field? And he used his maths to calculate that, which I found amazing. And he came up with a number, and that number was awful similar to the number that was being calculated at the time for the speed of light. So people were experimentally measuring the speed of light. And he found that his equations predicted that an energy wave would travel through this invisible electromagnetic force field at a speed that was very similar to what the experimental physicists were measuring for light. And so he made that connection. He realized that light was just energy being transported across this invisible force field that spanned all of space and time. Mind blowing. He looked at the rainbow, you know, those colors that he'd been obsessed with since a boy, and he realized that the rainbow of light was just different energy levels of light. And then this really is amazing, considering this was the late 1800s he was doing this. He realized that means there was more light than just the stuff we could see with our eyes. There would be very high energy light and very low energy light. And we call this light today the electromagnetic spectrum that goes all the way from those very high energy gamma rays through X-rays, ultraviolet, the visible light we can see, infrared, that's the light that's emitted by hot things, to microwave and radio wavelengths.
So it was 20 years before James Clerk Maxwell's theoretical predictions about light were realised, with an instrument not so dissimilar from this. This is called a Wimshurst machine, and it has a spark gap at the back. Now, what they found was that when they created a spark in an instrument like this, another spark was created in a circuit across the room. Somehow, information was being transferred from one part of the room to another through an electromagnetic wave, and that was a radio wave discovered by Hertz. Let's see this instrument in action. Here we go. The wheels are turning, creating static energy, and you can hear that spark. Let me show it to you. How cool is that?
Now, I said at the start that I am the Astronomer Royal for Scotland, and so it would be very remiss of me not to mention how the discoveries of one of Scotland's greatest scientists has revolutionised astronomy. If we only looked at the universe through optical light, we would be missing so much information about what's actually going on out there. This is the gorgeous image of the Pillars of Creation taken by the Hubble Space Telescope. It's a nebula where stars are being born out of these dense dust clouds. But optical light can't shine through these dust clouds, so we don't know what's happening inside these pillars unless we look in the infrared light, which can make its way through, showing us the baby protostars that are forming inside these dust clouds and the planetary disks that are creating planets around these new baby stars. Here's another interesting one. This is the Crab Nebula. It's what's left over after a gigantic explosion by a supernova. And depending which light we look in it, we learn different things. What's super exciting about the Crab Nebula is if we look in the X-ray and the gamma ray, we find that there's a very fast spinning neutron star right at the core that's been left over after this supernova explosion. More than 150 years on now from James Clerk Maxwell's revolutionary discovery about light, we are now building telescopes that can survey the universe, all of the different energy wavelengths that James Clerk Maxwell predicted with his amazing theory about light. And in doing so, we are learning about the birth of our universe, how the first galaxies and stars formed, how planets form around stars and create their own solar systems. And we are doing this both up in space, with the pictures you can see here, and with some gigantic ground-based telescopes on Earth.
So we've learned about James Clerk Maxwell's amazing scientific discoveries and how he revolutionised our understanding of light and the electromagnetic spectrum, paving the way for so much of the electronics and technology that we take for granted in our modern world. But what's all this got to do with Einstein? Well, Einstein is certainly one of my scientific heroes. And when I visited Washington, D.C. a few years ago, I got my photo taken sitting on his statue at the National Academy of Sciences. Like James Clerk Maxwell, Albert Einstein was a theoretical physicist and a very deep thinker who completely changed how we think about our universe and even what we mean when we talk about ideas like space and time. And I think it's fair to say that Einstein's influence was so great that he was more than just a famous scientist. Arguably, he's one of the most famous people, period, of the last 100 years. In fact, in 1999, Time magazine voted him Person of the Century. Although I should stress that was the editorial board's decision, there was also a public vote, and the public voted for Elvis Presley. Now, you know, the view on the front cover of the magazine shows Einstein as the kind of wise old genius, white-haired, slightly wild-eyed, with a touch of the mad scientist about him. But it's also fair to say that like James Clerk Maxwell, Einstein did a lot of his most fundamental breakthroughs when he was a relatively young scientist, a bit more like you see pictured here, which is from the early 1900s when he was a patent clerk in Switzerland. And that's where he developed his theory of special relativity, his theory of the nature of space and time. And that's where we pick up the story of how it connects to Maxwell's discoveries and Maxwell's legacy. Special relativity was all about trying to understand how the universe looks from different observers moving at different speeds. Now, we kind of do that in our everyday life all the time, almost on a subconscious level. For example, suppose we've got two trains traveling each at 50 miles per hour with respect to the train tracks. Our common sense would tell us that that means the two trains are approaching each other at 50 plus 50 or 100 miles per hour. But Albert Einstein was puzzled if this still worked when you were talking about light. He understood James Clerk Maxwell's theory of electromagnetic waves and his theory of light very well. And I suppose our common sense belief would be that if you've got a train, again, traveling at 50 miles per hour along the train tracks, and its headlamp shines a light beam forward, then the speed of the light beam, as measured by somebody standing alongside the tracks, would be the speed of light measured on the train plus 50 miles per hour. But it wasn't quite that simple. So Einstein was well aware that James Clerk Maxwell had proposed this beautiful theory that said that light was a wave caused by varying electric and magnetic fields. But what Einstein wanted to do was to ask a very profound question. What would happen if you were traveling alongside a ray of light? Would it still wave? Think of what happens when you're driving along the motorway going at 70 miles per hour, and you've got someone in the lane adjacent to you who's also traveling at 70 miles per hour. From your point of view, it looks as if that other car is basically stationary. You're staying the same distance apart as you travel along the motorway. You might stay like that for several miles before someone goes a little faster or a little slower. So you might think it should be like that with light. If light's produced by varying electric and magnetic fields, if you could run alongside a ray of light, would it still vary? Another way to think about this is that we associate magnetic fields, loosely speaking, with moving charges, moving electrical charges, and electric fields with static electrical charges. Now, what Einstein's theory of special relativity was all about was trying to make sense of how things look whether you're moving or static. Einstein believed that the laws of physics should be basically the same in those two cases. You might need to make some adjustments to take account of your speed, but the laws should still hold. The way the universe works shouldn't depend on whether or not you're moving. And he applied that in particular to James Clerk Maxwell's theory. He thought it was a really beautiful and elegant theory to describe the generation of light as an electromagnetic wave. So it really bothered Einstein that somehow the structure of Maxwell's equations and the structure of his theory could depend on how you were moving. That didn't seem to work for Einstein. It didn't sit well with them. So what he did instead was something really quite amazing. Einstein came up with the idea that in order to preserve the structure of Maxwell's beautiful theory, it had to be that the speed of light was actually the same, regardless of how fast you were moving. It would be measured to be the same speed by every observer, regardless of their motion. And that preserved Maxwell's theory, but what it did instead was upset the apple cart when it came to almost everything else, because it meant that our measurements of space and time would now depend on how you were moving. And as a little byproduct of all that, Einstein also showed the equivalence of matter and energy. That gave his famous E equals mc squared formula, where c is the speed of light. And it basically says that even a small amount of matter will have an incredible amount of energy locked up within it, if only we can release that. Now, Einstein didn't stop there. He published his paper on special relativity, in which he name-checked Maxwell in the very first sentence. He published that paper in 1905. And then he turned his thoughts from just describing how things look to observers moving at a constant speed to how things would look when they're moving at a different speed, when they're speeding up or slowing down, when they're accelerating. And he also wanted to incorporate gravity into his relativity theory. And he saw gravity as a bit of a problem. Isaac Newton had given us this notion of gravity as a force between massive bodies. So we can think of the moon orbiting the Earth because there's a balance, according to Newton, between the gravitational force pulling the moon towards the Earth and another force associated with its acceleration as it goes on a circular orbit around the Earth. So it kind of means you can think of the moon as falling towards the Earth, but it falls along its orbit and, of course, never gets any closer. Now, Einstein's problem with all of that arose really because he was troubled by a deep question. How does the moon even know that it's supposed to orbit the Earth? How does gravity act at a distance across space? So instead of thinking about gravity as a force, what Isaac Newton had proposed, what Albert Einstein developed instead, was a very different picture of gravity. But it took him a few years to get there. And along the way, what he came to realize in a really crucial leap of the imagination in 1907 was that gravity and acceleration are equivalent to each other. So if you're inside a spacecraft on the surface of the Earth, there's no windows, there's no other way that you can tell that you're sitting on the surface of the Earth. And if you drop an apple, it will fall to the ground. If you're on board that same spacecraft and you're accelerating through space and you drop an apple, it will also fall to the floor of your spacecraft. And if you have no other information than watching the apple fall, you simply won't be able to tell if you're in a gravitational field or if you're accelerating. Gravity and acceleration are equivalent. So this was key for Einstein to develop a picture of how gravity really works. He was able to see both gravity and acceleration as caused by space-time curvature. So we often capture that in terms of a little cartoon illustration like this, where we imagine space and time as a stretched sheet of rubber, like a trampoline. And you drop a heavy object on a trampoline, the surface of the trampoline will bend. So Einstein's picture of gravity imagines gravity as changing or bending the curvature of space-time. There's a nice phrase due to John Wheeler, an American physicist, that says space-time tells matter how to move and matter tells space-time how to curve. So, for example, the moon orbiting the Earth is doing that not so much because it's feeling a force from the Earth, like Newton said, but instead it's just following the curved contours of space-time represented by this cartoon, like the stretching of the rubber sheet in which the Earth is sitting. So Einstein was building on Maxwell's work in a lot of ways. Firstly, he developed his whole idea of the constancy of the speed of light to preserve the structure of Maxwell's equations for electromagnetic waves. And Maxwell also developed the idea of the electromagnetic field, that this was a property kind of built in to the fabric of the universe itself. And that's very much like what Einstein did for his idea of the gravitational field. Now, the field that I work in is called gravitational wave astronomy. And that's a very new field, but gravitational waves were actually predicted by Einstein's theory of relativity around 1915, 1916. So that's another link to Maxwell, because again, Maxwell's theory of electromagnetic waves, as we heard earlier, were only detected and generated in the laboratory a few decades later. In the case of gravitational waves, we had to wait much longer. We had to wait 100 years until those were detected. So what exactly are gravitational waves? Well, these are ripples in space and time caused by changing gravitational fields. So just as electromagnetic waves are produced by changing electric and magnetic fields, gravitational waves are produced by changing gravitational fields, such as you might get when two stars, for example, are orbiting around each other, close together that will send these ripples in space and time out through the universe. The problem is they're incredibly weak by the time they reach us, typically causing a disturbance in our patch of the universe less than a million millionth the width of a human hair. And in the early years of this decade, we began to operate what are called laser interferometers. So that's what the LI stands for in my LIGO sweatshirt here. These are the laser interferometer gravitational wave observatories, the LIGO observatories. There are two of them in the US, one in Washington State, one in Livingston, Louisiana. And what they do is they search for tiny changes in the curvature of space-time caused by passing gravitational waves. But they're incredibly minute, these signals, and that's why it took us 100 years before we detected the first one. Now, the way that the laser interferometer works is by stretching and squeezing of space-time being picked up as a change in the interference pattern of the light waves from laser beams that are sent along two perpendicular arms, just like this animation is showing. And then when those beams are recombined, if a gravitational wave has gone by, the stretching and squeezing of space-time will ever so slightly change the path traveled by the two waves, so they'll get out of step with each other and you'll get an interference pattern, hence laser interferometry. And on September 14th of 2015, the two LIGO detectors picked up their first signal coming from the collision of two black holes more than a billion light years away. And analysing that signal, we were able to work out that those black holes were about 30 times the mass of the Sun. And in just a matter of a few seconds, the signal that had come from a galaxy far, far away and travelled for more than a billion years to reach us, released the equivalent energy to three times the mass of the Sun. And that corresponds to a brightness, a luminosity of more than the light energy of every star in every galaxy in the entire universe. Now, since then, we've gone on to detect lots more gravitational wave signals. And in fact, in August 2017, we detected a signal coming from the merger of two neutron stars colliding together in a galaxy about 130 million light years away. And just about 1.7 seconds later, a signal was received from that same event, but in electromagnetic radiation, in gamma rays. In fact, it was subsequently observed all across the electromagnetic spectrum. So what this also tells us is that gravitational waves and electromagnetic waves travel at the speed of light, exactly as Einstein predicted. The reason the gamma rays arrived about 2 seconds later, we believe, is because they were emitted about 2 seconds later. Otherwise, they've traveled 130 million light years at exactly the same speed, the speed of light. So the ways in which Einstein's theories of gravity and relativity are tied together with James Clerk Maxwell's theories of light are manifold. They don't just help us to develop that theoretical foundation that would go on to predict the existence of gravitational waves. They also help us to detect the signals themselves based on using the laser light within the LIGO detectors, and also the observations that we are making across the whole electromagnetic spectrum, which in the case of that binary neutron star merger, helped to reveal a great deal about the nature of the object that caused the gravitational wave signal. So that's giving birth to a whole new field of astronomy that we call multi-messenger astronomy, where we observe the universe in both light and gravity. And that's a very exciting legacy of James Clerk Maxwell and of Einstein.
So we are wrapping up our tour now of James Clerk Maxwell's birthplace by showing you the Maxwell torch. This was designed for the Festival of Light, celebrating 150 years since the publication of his monumental groundbreaking theory on light. This torch has toured all of Scotland, sharing the life and legacy of James Clerk Maxwell that we've shared with you this evening. Martin, why do you think that Maxwell is Scotland's greatest scientist?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think for me, it's partly about the science discoveries that he made that we've been sharing with you this evening. His discoveries about colour, about the nature of Saturn's rings, about light, of course, and indeed some other remarkable discoveries that there's not been enough time to share with you. All of that is hugely impressive. But I think what really sells it to me is the way that he went about making those discoveries. It was almost the first time that we'd had someone who would build theoretical models, mathematical models to describe complex phenomena, and then to recognize that you could use those models to compare with what you observe and to try and test if those models were correct. And sometimes the testing came many years later. It was a long time later that we got really hard evidence from the Voyager probes that the rings of Saturn really are not made of solid material. And it was, as you said just a few minutes before, it was 20 years before Hertz was able to experimentally produce the electromagnetic waves that had been predicted.
Yeah.
And yet that's really part and parcel of how we do science now, that you have this relationship between observation and experiment on the one hand, theory on the other, and they don't always make progress at the same rate, but they kind of feed off each other to try and make sense of this amazing world we're in. So that, I think, is one of Maxwell's really crowning achievements, is just reshaping how we think about the world in terms of maths and theoretical physics. In that sense, he was very much building on the legacy of Newton.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like,
apple falls on heads.
Exactly, yeah, you know, that was a great leap of the imagination of Newton to devise the maths to describe apples falling and moon orbiting the Earth and all of that. And then he also kind of passed the baton on to Einstein, because as we were describing, his way of thinking about electromagnetic waves helped to pave the way for Einstein's theories of relativity. So in that sense, he very much is up there with Newton and Einstein, not just in terms of what he discovered, but how he made those discoveries. And given that he died when he was really rather young, who's to say, perhaps if he'd lived a little longer, he might well have been the one that made the breakthroughs that we attribute now to Einstein. We truly could be talking about, you know, Scotland's Einstein. But even if we give Einstein that,
that
there's no question, as we have discussed, that Einstein himself recognised just how important Maxwell's discoveries were as a step towards Einstein's remarkable theories.
So if you would like to come and visit the birthplace of what Martin and I consider to be Scotland's greatest scientists, 14 India Street in Edinburgh. It's run by the James Clerk Maxwell Foundation, and we're very grateful for them for letting us film here today. You need to book an appointment, just go online, but you can come and see all of the things that we've shown you today and more.
And looking ahead, in 2031, it will be 200 years since James Clerk Maxwell was born in this very building where we are this evening. And, you know, we can only hope that by then, more and more people across the country will be aware of just how important a scientist James Clerk Maxwell was and continues to be in the legacy that he leaves behind. So if you've enjoyed this lecture, maybe you can help spread the word for us and tell your friends, tell your family just how important this scientist was as we build up towards Maxwell's 200th birthday.
Thanks very much, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Oh, thank you so much. That's such a brilliant little film. It looked like you had such fun making it. I saw there was a blooper reel of it that you put out on Twitter, and that's equally well, more amusing, less important. I just want to start. By the way, everyone, please post your questions if you haven't posted questions already. I want to start with a question which Andy Saws, who's an illustrious colleague of yours, asked in the chat, which is, could it be argued that James Clerk Maxwell is not Scotland's Einstein, but Einstein is Germany's James Clerk Maxwell? And what he says is, JCM's problem he puts it in inverted commas, was he didn't live to be proved right and be a celebrity scientist.
Yeah, I think there's something really in that, that, you know, he died at the age, was it 48, Martin?
48, that's right, yeah.
And so he didn't have the chance to tour the world and you know, be the great scientist and sort of show off his theories. And I think there was another comment earlier by Ruth. She sort of quoted that he was thought he was away with the fairies when he came up with this crazy idea. You know, he was so far ahead of his time, and it took until Hertz discovered the radio wave before he was proved right, which was, you know, long after his death. I think that's definitely part of it, that he just didn't have the chance to
I agree. There's a really intriguing irony here, because it was precisely the developments in electromagnetism and then the practical applications of that, which people like Hertz and Marconi invented, that allowed Einstein's fame to spread so rapidly. There's a number of other, you know, interesting factors at work too, because the experiment that was carried out in 1919 to verify Einstein's general relativity was carried out by Eddington, a number of other scientists as well, but Eddington was the most prominent. And that was also a kind of media, you know, gold dust to have this just 1 year after the Great War ended, a German scientist's theory being verified by a British astrophysicist. So, you know, the circumstances helped to build that Einstein legacy, just because it was already the 20th century. And of course, the 21st century is even more like that, because of the way that ideas can spread rapidly through, you know, social media and so on.
Well, I was going to ask you that, because obviously you've got this idea of, I mean, in a way it's quite nice. You've got your Newton, Maxwell, Einstein, this idea of science as a collaborative process and as a continuum. And who would you say are the most significant people at the moment building on James Clerk Maxwell's legacy? And is it even worth thinking in that way anymore about these sort of great individuals? Or is science now about data and, you know, data?
Yeah, I'd say science is big team. So Martin here is wearing his LIGO shirt there. And, you know, it's a phenomenal discovery of the LIGO team of those gravitational waves. But it was a massive team of people. And you see that in particle physics now, you know, that the Higgs boson, of course, Higgs won his Nobel Prize for predicting it. But the team that discovered it was absolutely huge. And I think gone are the times when science is done by a single white male, if you'll forgive me, Andrew. Sort of beavering away now. It really is a collaborative, creative effort, and I think that's also kind of also made science maybe more accessible to more people as well, because it requires people with all different backgrounds and ideas and ways of solving problems to come up with these big discoveries. And you need all sorts of different skills to make that happen. You need both the maths that Maxwell was so good at, you also need the engineers, the designers, the statisticians, the people who do the data analysis. There's so many different skill sets that are required to make the big discoveries that we're trying to answer, the big questions we're trying to answer today.
And it's interesting, you mentioned, sorry, Martin, the gravitational wave. So last night we had Emily Levesque from the University of Washington. In her book, there's a very good layperson's description of all the activity that took place immediately after this gravitational wave is discovered. All these teams around the world immediately leaping into action, demanding telescope time, and this balance between competition and collaboration that is sort of modern science.
Absolutely. I mean, that's a challenge that I think you might almost argue is an inhibitor for innovation, because the teams need to be so large to undertake these complex projects, but it builds into them a great deal of inertia. So it means that when a new and radical idea does come along, maybe, you know, a graduate student within one of the groups in our big collaboration, it's not always so easy for that student to get their voice heard. So, you know, we certainly don't want to suggest that everything has all been solved. I mean, on the contrary, you know, I'm sure Catherine will be the same. I tell our students that we know less about the universe now than we thought we did when I was a student. It's just that the manner in which we acquire new knowledge is sort of subtly changed by having those large
almost unwieldy collaborations. And you know, they're a necessary part of the process, but they can often make it hard for the real leaps of the imagination to burst through.
Absolutely. And do you think, I mean, you know, there have been, you know, famously, again, for lay people, the thing that we're interested in science is what are seen as sort of paradigm shifts. You know, those moments where science changes its sort of basis and changes its fundamental principles that underlie everything. How many of those are left? Or are everything going to be incremental?
I'm sure that there'll be plenty more. I mean, a good example, I will absolutely defer to Catherine in a moment on this because she's way more expert than me. But as a kind of humble, you know, gravitational astrophysicist, I've always been intrigued by these questions around dark matter and dark energy. But one aspect of that I was more directly involved in over recent years was getting that embedded into the senior phase of the high school physics curriculum in Scotland. And it was with the specific purpose of not presenting it as a done deal, but presenting it as an example of how we make incremental progress and we apply, you know, a tried and trusted method to make sense of complicated data. And often what it results in is precisely that paradigm shift that you allude to. So, you know, what do you think, Catherine? Is that maybe where the next big one will be?
People who haven't heard these terms, dark matter and dark energy, we have these dark components in our universe that we really don't understand what they are. We've known about them for quite some time now. So in some ways, that's a bit of a failure for us as the scientists that we don't know what these dark components are. I keep hoping my particle physics cousins will create a dark matter particle in CERN or catch one, but they haven't yet. And I do worry that by the time I retire, because I do a lot of talks about my research on dark matter, I do worry that by the time I retire, I'll be like, oh no, I've been telling people about dark matter fairly all along. So I think that our final understanding of that is going to have to involve some paradigm shift because we can't explain it with the physics that we know from Newton, James Clerk Maxwell and Einstein. So we need something else out there. But at the moment, there's no compelling single theory to give us something new out there. But with more data, so we had a chat on the YouTube chat about all of the different projects that are coming up. There's amazing new technology coming online that's going to allow us to see things we've never seen in the universe before across that whole electromagnetic spectrum that James Clerk Maxwell predicted. And that's always the best way to solve a problem, just throw more tech at it, more data. We'll see what we find.
And of course, you get lots of nice spin-off technology from that as well, which is the, you know, the other motivation for doing physics. I mean, certainly not mine, and I suspect it's not yours, Catherine, but it's a nice corollary to all the deep thinking about the fundamental problems.
We've got great questions coming here from Anna Levin, who I believe wrote a book about light and light pollution. But she asks, it's almost a philosophical question. She says, do you think we've more to learn about what light is?
I would say so. I think that although Maxwell's maths is so beautiful as a theory and as we tried to capture, it sort of inspired Einstein to take the next leap forward with relativity. All of that is what we term a classical theory of light. And that means where you model the fields that we talked about as smooth, continuous functions of how space works. But we know that the universe isn't built like that. It's built in terms of the rules of quantum physics, where things come in discrete packets. And that's part, I think, of the kind of dichotomy you have that has led to dark matter and dark energy being unsolved problems. As Catherine says, that's why we have to look to our particle physics friends maybe to solve that one. So, yeah, I mean, for me, that's probably going to lead to a new appreciation and a new understanding of the nature of light itself if we ever can unify the sort of relativistic smooth picture of the universe with the quantum description.
So is that going to put astronomers out of jobs? You'll all be replaced by quantum physicists?
Oh, no, not at all. No, we've got oodles to discover. We've got new telescopes going on. James Webb is going to be discovering exoplanets around other stars. We've got a whole universe to explore out there.
Now, I know you're both not, you're not historians of science, so to speak, but do you think, I mean, did Maxwell realise what he'd done was revolutionary? Did he realise the significance of it? Would he be amazed if he came back? If Maxwell came back tomorrow, yeah. We could bring him back, what would he think?
Well, that's a great question. I can only really give an answer as a, as you say, an amateur science historian. But all I've read about him suggests that, well, firstly, I think he would have been amazed at what we have gone on to do and to learn, because he did almost have a childlike wonder and awe of the natural world. And I think he would have been rather chuffed to think that his theory played a part in how that's all unfolded. But, you know, would he have fully anticipated all that's been developed, you know, especially in all the applications of electromagnetism, everything from, you know, mobile phones to microwaves? I suspect maybe not, you know, and again, he wouldn't have had to live too much longer to see the first inklings of that. But because he died when he was so young, it really was a very different world. It was, you know, only the very earliest years of telegraphy. So all the developments that would follow through Marconi and so on, he just missed out on that.
What do you think do you think there's out of the inventions that he inspired, what would have astonished him most?
What would have astonished him? I think maybe looking at the universe through all of the different wavelengths. I think that, because that astounds me still, that you see different things depending which type of light you look at.
I think that slide that you brought up during the film is extraordinary, where you see these sort of six different, I was going to say filters, they're not filters, but you've got that sense, haven't you? Yeah,
you can think about that. So that was the Crab Nebula. It's producing light all the way across the electromagnetic spectrum, but the really fast spinning neutron star at the core, the pulsar, is emitting in the very, very high energy X-ray and gamma rays, and you can see that sort of swirling core. But then what's left around it is all of the sort of dust and explosion from the supernova, and that's what you see in the optical and the near infrared. And it's that eventually reforms to create new stars and planets and people like us. So we are all made out of that supernova dust that you saw in that picture, that you can see in that different types of light. That's certainly what astounds me from looking across the electromagnetic spectrum. But sort of everyday life as well, just making life easy for people, you know, your mobile phone, how easy is that? Sat nav. just ways of communication. I think he would never have imagined that would be possible. The fact that we're doing this tonight, I mean, I'm sat in Edinburgh, Martin's in Glasgow, you're down in Wigtown, you know, that we can talk to each other in real time. This is phenomenal.
Absolutely. And do you think, Martin, you mentioned, and I mean, as I mentioned in the introduction, Catherine, you spent a good proportion of your time as Astronomer Royal for Scotland, concentrating on education, looking particularly at schools and that idea of sort of how we engage school children. And Martin, you mentioned getting science, James Clerk Maxwell, into the curriculum.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking about Maxwell himself, and he came from a pretty wealthy, posh family, but he's born in 1831. But he grows up in this kind of environment where he can bring all this stuff around him. He can feed off the kind of intellectual climate of the time. Do you think we're doing enough to create that kind of climate, particularly for young people today?
Well, it's a very good question. I mean, how shall I put this? Maxwell was still a rather humble man, you know, a humble person. So I think he can still function very well as an example of how, you know, even someone from relatively humble beginnings can achieve greatness if they are, you know, have the sufficient dedication, sufficient energy and enthusiasm, you know, the old cliche, if you can achieve anything if you put your mind to it. So in those terms, it is unfortunate that he's not better known. Again, you know, we can probably all think of examples of role models where their early life is so far removed from the everyday experience of young children today that they might aspire to be like that person, but there's no realistic prospect that they would ever be able to do it. But, you know, that's not really the case with Maxwell. And again, it's just all about his curiosity and fascination with the world. And, you know, all you really need is that spark of imagination. And, you know, whatever we might think of our formal education system, it can do most of the rest, really. Einstein has a great quote like that. He says that he never taught anyone. He just created the conditions in which they learned for themselves. And that's really what Maxwell did, you know.
Well, that's education leading out, isn't it? That's the whole, meant to be the whole principle.
Indeed.
Okay, well, look, I'm going to bring the event home, as we say now. And I'm going to bring it home to the home of James Clerk Maxwell. And last question is, and remember, 14 India Street, and you can, I think you're probably going to have a flood of bookings now.
Oh, we hope so.
You've been around the house. You've been let loose in the house on your own. If you had one object, each of you, that you could steal, what would it be? What would you take home? I mean, maybe you have already. I don't know. But.
For me, it was actually one thing that we couldn't squeeze into the film show, but it was one of the earliest things that he did was he worked out the mathematics of ellipses. And there's his notes of how he did all of that. And how old was he at the time, Martin? 14 or something?
Oh,
crazy.
Yeah, absolutely.
He worked out the mathematics of ellipses. And it was presented at the Royal Society of Edinburgh, but he was too young to present it himself. So his uncle presented it for him or something. I can't remember who actually presented it for him, but an adult presented it for him. Anyway, for me, when I got there, I was just looking at it going, oh my God, I was dancing to the Spice Girls when I was 14 years old. I mean, there's, he was doing this most amazing mathematics. So that's the one thing, well, I wouldn't steal, but that was the one thing I was really excited about. Yeah,
absolutely.
Martin,
well,
were you dancing at the Spice Girls when you were 14?
Well, not quite. I'm of a rather older vintage, but I was telling Catherine, you know, that if one thinks of, again, as you say, you know, what you were doing when you were the equivalent age, it does kind of leave you thinking, well, geez, you know, what have I achieved with my life when you look at what Maxwell managed? But I think what impresses me most is the fact that he was great at all the theory, but he also was great at building contraptions to try out the theory. So, you know, there are some examples of that around the Maxwell house. And I think that's almost like a lost art. You know, I played a lot with Lego when I was growing up. I was probably still doing that when I was 14, actually, instead of when I should have been dancing to the Spice Girls. But you know, I think that's the kind of aspect of Maxwell that I can really identify with, the fact that you just love sort of building things and making contraptions. So one of these is called a zoetrope. It's part of, you know, the very earliest attempts to have moving images, just using the fact that the persistence of vision on our eye means that if you have multiple images seen through a slit, then your brain will fill in the gaps. So there's lots of examples of that around, but this was a particularly beautiful one that they've got in the Maxwell House. And again, if we'd had a bit more time, we would have shown you that one as well.
Oh, well, brilliant. Well, when you're on your desert island, you can play with your zoetrope. So anyway, thank you so much for such a wonderful evening, such a wonderfully creative way of going through his life. I think it's really brought it to life for us all. Our next Big Bang Week event brings more stardust, I guess, with Emma Chapman. He's going to be talking about first light and the beginnings of stars tomorrow at 3 p.m. I really hope that everyone here tonight can join us or we'll watch that on catch up. But in the meantime, I just want to say thank you so much to Professor Catherine Heymans and Professor Martin Hendry for coming and being part of Big Bang Week. And let's keep on celebrating James Clerk Maxwell.
Thanks very much, Adrian.
Thank you very much. Bye, everybody.